those who do not love me do not keep my word. The whole thrust of this farewell discourse in the upper room is that of friendship with the Lord, and in that friendship, union with the Father and union amongst ourselves. Indeed, he prays in the 17th chapter for this perfect unity. But one cannot be in union with the one whose will one doesn't obey. It applies in human relationships, it applies in any love relationship, in any friendship relationship, in any relationship at all where dynamics are involved. If we know that we're doing something against the express wish or even the secret wish of someone that we know well and go ahead, then we're damaging that relationship. And in marriage, there is usually a point at which, for the first time, that seriously starts to happen, and for the first time, there is a jarring note. Maturity will get over it, but then it's not as before. Something has happened, and it's not as it was before. The will is the essence. Any expression without the will can be a lie. So, when it comes to our God, something of that comes through. At Fatima, the first cycle was Eucharistic. The angel coming, adoring, and actually giving Holy Communion. There was a teaching of prayer, which is reparatory, and which is very much one of adoration and recognition. So this reparation comes in straight away in the whole thrust of Fatima and will come again and again in the course of the century in interventions from heaven. The whole question of what happened in the 60s at Garabandal is still unclear, but it has been carefully re-examined because of the U-turn was done by the scientist that had weighed the balance against it, and he went public and said he had not spoken sufficiently balancedly, and it came quite back on track because the bishop came on board and his successor. So that's been very much looked at again. And with that, we have also much on not only photograph, but also on cine, which means that we can see miracles happening before our eyes, and that's not easy to fabricate. So that also is extremely Eucharistic as well as Marian. Now, reparation comes in precisely when we have a situation where the Lord, through people who are little eyes for us children, are told what is displeasing to heaven in a way that children and therefore adults can understand. Because what's happening is this. It's as in a couple where the expressions are there but the will is not, the person will feel it. Because one is, as it were, taking a part of the other person without the essence one is using. Well, our Jesus feels something the same, but worse, when it comes to being used. If there is no love in our encounter, when he gives himself without defense, totally and utterly, into our heart, there is a lie, there is a pain. The angels see it, the angels feel it. This morning, in the chapel, in the hermitage, for a second, I had to make an operation with regard to getting some books ready, hymn books or whatever it was, and I noticed, I've got my backside to Blessed Sacrament. I thought, that's against all my formation in the monastery, and also against what was told, or what actually happened, it would seem, at Garabandal. Do you know that every time they were in ecstasy, they would zoom, wherever they were, eventually towards where the Lord was, in the tabernacle, and at a certain point they would bite up against it, and they would never, while they were in a state of trance, ever physically be able to turn their back on the tabernacle. They always walked backwards before it when they were going out. So that in itself would be a lesson, but we were also taught it. And so were the nuns of perpetual adoration. You do not turn your back on the Blessed Sacrament. It's not quite so easy, but that was the formation we were given instinctively. And by the way, it's still there liturgically. If one is facing the cross of the tabernacle while celebrating, one is not allowed to turn one's back on the Blessed Sacrament after the consecration. You know how it's done. It's still there. In the New Rite hasn't changed that. Once the Blessed Sacrament is there on the altar, There are some occasions when the priest has to turn round, but after the consecration, it's all right before, but afterwards he has to go to one side. So, for instance, when it comes to the moment when he gives the sign of peace, he turns towards the people and he has to go to one side at that point. You go there, and also when he has the best sacrament in his hand, even though he has the best sacrament in his hand, when he says, "Behold the Lamb of God," he's not allowed to turn his back on the chalice, he has to go to one side. So that's how it's done still. Because in the monastery we had it still, the new rite, but facing the other way, and we were taught that from the beginning. Never turn your back on the blessed sacrament. So that was all our formation. He is our God. Now, all that to say that this is an expression of something deeper, which was actually inculcated to these little children. What were they taught to do by the angel? They were taught to not only kneel, but prostrate themselves with their forehead touching the ground, with this wonderful prayer of adoration and reparation, which we can learn off by heart and use. And also the prayer, which is a very simple one, which we adore and love and make reparation, ask pardon for those who don't. That's something simple. I actually have the instinct for years, I've had it every time the bell goes at the hour to say that prayer, and also to add a prayer for the deceased, Requiem Aeternam and so on, which is indulgence. So if one is doing that, one is both saving souls every hour and also helping souls in purgatory. It's kind of, as it were, punctuating time, stopping time, using time, and remembering also that we've got to go at the end of our innings, because each time is closer to our own death, Requiem Aeternam, we're getting closer to each hour. In a monastery it's easier because one hears the bell, but there are bells ringing anyway. And also I have alarms, which is, by the way, jolly useful. If one has one's mobile phone programmed to give out the Angelus, for instance, that kind of thing, and the Hour of Mercy, well, one's got, if you like, the bell. And it does work. And I had one time with me some young travelling lasses in the house one time, and my thing went off at 6 o'clock, and hers at the same time. She was in her early 20s, and I thought, wow, that's good witness. She's ordinary travelling girl, big into prayer, as was her whole family. But she had the instinct, yes, program these things on your mobile. So it works. And if one has a Catholic with one, one can say the Angelus. Why not? It didn't do any harm. I remember one time we were in a novitiate outing, and I was novice master there, and we went out somewhere, I think we went to Rome or somewhere, and we were in the station at Grosseto, and we had our office books with us. I remember the novice saying, "Oh, we can sing it, they won't die of it." So we sang it in the platform of the station, who cares? So anyway, witness value. And so it actually doesn't do any harm at all. People are actually quite impressed. One time I remember making the sign of the cross in France one time before breakfast, and this whole band of Eastern Europeans, this was going years back now, before the communist curtain had fallen, there was still very much persecution, they were taken aback and they were over the moon because they were secret Christians out there. And they were edified. So these things can touch people more than we think. The sign of the cross we're not afraid of when we pass the church. If we are afraid of it, why? Are people more important than Jesus? Now, what I want to zoom into is this. The second cycle of Fatima went into things directly Marian, and July was an important part of it. The showing of hell was the second part of the secret. They were shown it directly. And they were also given to understand the importance of certain things. Notably, the importance of what heaven was providing as a means of saving the world from the atrocities of atheism spreading everywhere. Devotion to the Immaculate Heart, consecration to the Immaculate Heart of Mary, and the Rosary. It's the one thing asked for each time with insistence. Now, two things. With regard to the consecration of the Immaculate Heart, I open a parenthesis which is not indifferent. It's that I've been approached by the heavies of prayer to have in Johnstown, but in English, a mass where we will reconsecrate Ireland to the Immaculate Heart and to the Sacred Heart, the fourth best sacrament exposed there, in the ambit of what's attacking the unborn. That's in a week's time. We had thought of doing it on the 13th of May, but it wasn't the right time. There were too many things going on that day. We're doing it on Wednesday, the feast of the Our Lady Help of Christians, which again takes us back to the two pillars. Remember John Bosco? He saw the rough sea and this vessel with the Pope on it there, and it was between these two pillars. One had the Blessed Sacrament on it, and the other, Our Lady, Help of Christians. So that's what we're going to do at 7 o'clock in the evening at Johnstown, if you're that way inclined. We'll be using that church, and it'll be just people like yourselves, all the programs of the area, wanting it. We had the same kind of thing years ago in another church. It was actually the Augustine Church in Drogheda on the night of the Immaculate Conception. We did the same thing. It was well attended. It was very intense because they were all into prayer like yourself, all the programs of the area. So that works very well, and it's very reverent because we don't do anything shortcut. It's kind of just calm, prayer, with plenty of time. And we usually have a calm music ministry behind it to keep it going, sustained without any jazzy stuff. Now, the other thing I wanted to mention is this, the secret of hell. Now, there's a reason for that. If there was a reason already in 1917, there would be a far more powerful reason for doing something similar now, should there be ever any question. It's the fact that basically even very intellectual Catholics managed to brush aside the real issue of hell, because God is so merciful that he couldn't possibly, etc., etc., etc. It's actually not that at all, that we're not merciful to ourselves, and God can't bear the thought of a soul being lost, but a soul doesn't want to see God and chooses not to see God if it's in a state of mortal sin at the moment of dying. And people dismiss that question of the possibility of being in mortal sin when they're dying. Well, let me tell you, my friends, there are souls in mortal sin, and more than we think. One can observe it. There are patterns of behaviour which come from mortal sin. Once you attack certain themes, what happens? Aggression, harshness, there's a fear, there's a profound refusal. It's the fundamental option of no towards grace, the sin against the Holy Spirit. That is the choices of the soul itself. It was seen that at the moment of death, there's an increase of grace, and there's a huge combat going on around the soul between the angelic forces, good and bad, and that there is a grey area at the moment of death where the Lord is trying to get through with supernatural graces at the maximum, and there is, it would seem, a kind of no man's land at the moment of death, which might be more than a few seconds, it might be 2 minutes, maximum three, when the soul is hovering, and there's some kind of possible illumination going on there, that the soul is made aware fully, do you realize? And it might have some chance there. That comes from Maria Simba. She seems to be aware of there's some kind of no man's land there, where there's something happening, we don't quite know. But anyway, the point is this, it's only a very short moment of possible lucidity, even if they're in a coma, when, okay, it's all forever played, and irreversibly. At that point, the choice is respected. God can't do any more, and then the eyes open. Oh. 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 And forever. Do you know what forever means? Do you know what no space exists? Can you imagine the universe without a lid? Can you imagine time without end? We can't. We just can't imagine it. Well, then we'll see what it is. Because the big difference between the lowest level of purgatory and hell is this. There's no end. One speaker said, the lowest level of purgatory and hell work on the same heating system. Mm-hmm. In other words, actually it goes back to theologians like Thomas Aquinas, that in the lowest level of purgatory, the same flame is at work. There's a distance there which is not that great between the lowest level of purgatory and hell. It's very close, and it can go on for a long time. And that's the last possible hope for somebody who's really in a bad way. God tries to get them into there rather than the other place. Now, if you don't believe what I'm saying, listen to this. This came to the post the other day from a lady who picked it up and had promised to send it to me. It's just an ordinary Irish paper, nothing Catholic at all. It's the Irish Daily Mail. And this was November the 21st. And it's interesting because of the fact it's neutral. This was a very qualified medic, anaesthetist, who was spending hours and hours beside people who we had to put to sleep during operations and keep them asleep. And he'd be getting stories sometimes from them about things that had gone on. He dismissed them. Oh, yeah, I'll talk about it later. Until one day he himself went under the knife. His tone of voice changed considerably. So, he saw that he was coming out of his body. He was aware that something big was changing. He could see the operation going on. He even heard an inappropriate joke, which was funny, but not to be repeated. Interesting what doctors say when they're doing these operations. But then it ceased to be funny at all. Slowly, my consciousness began to return. I could see the ceiling approaching, the glossy surface slowly getting closer. Then I looked down and saw my own abdomen, now with several incisions. I heard the anaesthetist make an off-colour joke. I won't repeat it, but everyone in the operating theatre laughed, including me. But where was I? For a few moments, I froze with fright, worried that whatever was holding me up on the ceiling would suddenly let me drop. Suddenly, I became aware of a shift in my perspective as my field of vision expanded. I was still in the operating theatre, but at the same time, I could see my mother and sister sitting on a sofa in our family home, thousands of miles away in New Delhi, where I'd grown up. It's all very puzzling. You can see what his sister is wearing and describes it. But then other things start to happen. He is recalled to what's going on underneath. I was so focused on them that the sudden sound of instruments clanking in the operating theatre gave me a start. Turning my head to the left, I found I could still see and hear the scene below me. This guy's a mess. He's lucky to be here. It goes on. I was now seriously frightened. What was going on? Would my untethered consciousness ever get back into my body? Or was I destined to roam through eternity as a spirit? Was I dead? I felt like an astronaut who'd left his spacesuit only to find that a suit was unnecessary to begin with. With rising panic, I looked back and forth at the two scenes until both started to fade like a fast setting sun. Everything went dark. I was relieved. I'm returning to my body, I thought. Then came a jolt of pure fear. To my right, I heard screams of pain and anguish. I was drawn in as if on a moving pavement to the edge of a flaming canyon. Smoke filled my nostrils, and with it the sickening odour of burning flesh. I knew then that I was on the lip of hell. I tried to turn away, but each time I took a step back, an unseen force moved me forward. A voice spoke to me telepathically. You have led a materialistic and selfish life. He knew it was true. He treated his patients not as persons, but as means of gain. And there's a whole list why he saw that his situation was not at all interesting, given where he was at. I jump, and he cries out, this time sincerely, "My God, give me another chance. Please give me another chance." Now, what is interesting is that this man is a Hindu, an Indian. He is given another chance. When he comes back, he changes his life completely and starts to help people, and not to make gain. Not to have a big house, but genuinely to do all he can to help patients, and he's helpful at home. He's given a message, a feeling, an awareness, which is really interesting given his background. It's that the whole force driving the universe and its meaning is love. And that's what he comes back with, and it changes his orientation. So, what is interesting about this is it's not from a Catholic paper, an ordinary daily paper, which is published as it comes, and which actually says it all. Because it's not alone. These experiences now are more frequent because of what's happening in medical skill, able to call people back, but also because they're able to monitor the vibrations in the brain, indicating that brain death has occurred, and that when these souls are going on and able to remember conversations and the brain is not functioning, it means, yes, that a soul is not dependent on the brain. So that scientific fact which corroborates faith. And here, therefore, you can't so easily as before dismiss it, which is the whole basis of materialism. The whole concept of Marxism is that the material is the important business. It's not. This is a new issue for science. It can't get away from it. We can see that we're not going to stop being. A soul conceived will never, ever stop being. So if one looks around the planet, as Our Lady can, as the angels can, one sees why heaven is weeping and why it's a serious mess. If she indicated the number of souls going into hell already in 1917 when there was faith, what would she be seeing now? Some have said that it has been shown that the number of souls falling into hell all the time is similar to snowflakes falling to the ground. Now we have theologians and bishops who in some way succeed in anesthetizing souls against the risk. But if a lady showed a 9-year-old, actually, she was smaller. She was 9 when she died. She was only 6 or 7 when she saw them. If that was her lesson, and she's the best of mothers, it means, my friends, that we need to take Fatima seriously, and also the remedy. Daily rosary. If we're too busy, it means we're too busy. Order is what we need. And take it as heaven wants it, otherwise that's one more thorn in Our Lady's crown. Do it well, and do it with love. And also live the first Saturdays. Reparation is heard and felt by the best of mothers, who weeps to see one soul lost forever.